Second session of mine, and yesterday we started our discussion on the IoT technologies and in particular the protocol stack we were started with, and we have discussed about the full protocol stack, which is I have just shown you the full protocol stack which is here. And then I have started a little bit more discussion on the individual protocols and the link layer protocols, in particular the Wi-Fi protocol. We have discussed about that there are five basic classes, right? To tell them different technologies may not be appropriate, but these are five different standards. So, and each one of them is a separate protocol. Okay, the basic principle of every protocol here, whether it is 802.11a to 802.11ad, is the downward compatibility. That 802.11ad that will also allow, or it will also function with the devices 802.11a. okay, now the only exception here is 802.11n actually, which is a dual band radio technology. Dual band here means there generally you have a 2.4 gigahertz radio and you have another 5 gigahertz radio. And 802.11n, though now most of the installations has moved away from 802.11n to AC, AD is still evolving. AD has not means commercial, at least I have not seen any commercial products on AD. In 802.11n, generally what was happening is device to device communication or device to access point communication was on 2.4 gigahertz, and then access point communication was on 5 gigahertz bands. That's how the dual radio was being used. And all the three, the lower three, they are based on MIMO technologies, that is multiple input and multiple output beams actually. So you have the in 802.11a, b and g you have single antenna, whereas in N, AC and AD you have multiple antennas. So basically there is an array of antennas which is placed. And so when we are talking about the size, you can just imagine if you have AC or AD, then placing an array of antenna, that a miniaturization of what extent is required for placing multiple antennas on that small size devices. Okay, then this is a WiMAX protocol, 802.16m. So generally here what we have is this is generally used for a base station to base station communication. The Wi-Fi technology is used for last mile connectivity, whereas 802.16f is from base station to base station for wide area networks. So speeds for vary depending upon the kind of type of station which we are having. 100 Mbps is achieved for mobile stations, whereas 1 Gbps is available. Up to 1 Gbps is available for fixed stations. So the data rates, depending upon the other factors, the data rates may be a little bit slower. This is personal area network, that is wireless personal area network. This is a low rate network, and this is the primary concern here is the power consumption, that we want to have a communication for shorter distances. Wi-Fi will require more power, so to bring down the power consumption, where we need to have very short distance communication, say within few meters actually, then and data rates are also not very high, the data rates required are also not very high. So we can have short range and short small power devices, and that's how. So it provides you low cost. Cost here means with regard to the power actually. So and low speed communication for power constrained devices. Okay, now the another aspect here is the IO interfaces. And here the IoT devices offer you a large choice actually. So if you see the IO interfaces, you have UART, SPI, I2C, CAN. In fact, you will find some HDMI and audio video interfaces also. So you require multiple interfaces here. That is first and foremost thing which you need to understand, that we have IO interfaces for sensors, interfaces for internet connectivity, whether it is more often than not, it will either be wireless communication, where you will have some antennas, 802.11 based antennas, or not very often, but yes, not that rarely also, you will have the wired connectivity also. So RJ45 is also there. Then you will require the memory and storage interfaces, and then audio video interfaces. So the number of interfaces required on an IoT, depending upon the application, may be quite large. So particularly when you are using the cameras, IoT means is equipped with a camera, then yes, the video interfaces are quite complex in nature. May not be an HDMI interface, but yes, still the camera interfaces are quite expensive in terms of the power consumption also. So these are some of the technical challenges which it will you will need to address. Okay, and this is where we concluded yesterday, that is the all these multiple technologies of wireless communication, how do they fit. So generally you have this saffron color or the red, the orange color, and this is generally for short, means GPS, 4L, this is the last mile connectivity, whereas the WiMAX and all these are from endpoint to endpoint, access point to access point communication. And then you have the other technologies which are generally used for very short distance within meters only. Okay, now these are the application, these are some other protocols which will be there, and these are for the application layers. Okay, so just from this I have already discussed. So these are the constraint application protocol, message queue, telemetry transport, extensible messaging and presence protocol, that is XMPP, and then you have the low power wireless personal area network. Okay, let me just give you a brief introduction of each one of them. Okay, and then you have these 2G, 3G and 4G, now 5G is also coming up. So GSM and CDMA was the standard for 2G. In 3G, you have the standards UMTS and CDMA 2000. 4G is LTE, that's a single standard, but 5G, we are still not sure that what kind of standards 5G would offer, but yes, 5G is still work in progress. Not many things have been frozen with regard to 5G. In fact, deployment, forget about the deployment, even testing has not started, and there are lot many other considerations, because most of the countries, most of the 5G work started in China, and a large number of countries including India, they have serious concerns with regard to any technology developed in China. So 5G work is completely halted, or more or less halted, and most of the countries have banned the equipment from China, and so now each country is having its own development for 5G. Okay, then you have the network and the internet layer protocols. Here the IP is there, but in IP you have the two versions, two IPv4 and IPv6, and so tunneling is also required in some cases. Still not very sure whether IPv6 can be used, or IPv6 would be used, or IPv4 would be used. So far both of these technologies are coexisting, but future seems to be moving towards IPv6, but let us see how the technology finally settles down. So it is responsible for sending of IP datagrams from source to destination network. That is a very, very standard purpose of the network layer, and performs the host addressing and packet routing. So addressing, which when we are discussing about, then yes, addressing is the responsibility of the internet layer, and then host identification is done using hierarchical IP addressing schemes such as IPv4 or IPv6. Okay, IPv6 over low power wireless personal area network, that is the only new protocol actually, which is especially designed for IoTs, and it is used for devices with limited processing capacity. That is the case with the IoT devices, and it operates in 2.4 gigahertz. See, one thing needs to be understood that the wireless IPv4 or IPv6 and wired IPv4 or IPv6 are slightly different actually. Okay, so the IPv4 over wireless networks like IoT requires some kind of changes actually. I may not have that much of time available to me that I can go into the details of what changes you need to make to IPv4 to make it suitable for wireless networks. But yes, few changes are required, particularly in routing. And if it is some mobility also, then yes, there will be some more changes. Okay, the transport layer, again, transport, so far the network layer is within the network. Now it's an end-to-end transport layer is responsible for end-to-end message transfer. And the other aspect is whether it is IPv4 or IPv6, the transport layer needs to really work with the IPv4 and IPv6 both. So error control, segmentation, flow control, congestion control, these are all standard functions of the transport layer. And the two protocols which are used are again TCP and UDP. So because each one of you are well familiar with these two protocols, I don't need to go into the details of these two protocols. Okay. Now, the HTTP is slightly different in case of the IoT. Let us see what are those differences. A very small, not very large differences, but slightly different. So forms the foundation of WWW, that is that we are all familiar with. And this is basically, it uses the universal resource identifiers to identify HTTP resources. And the model here is the request response model. Request response model means a request is initiated by the client side, the one which needs the information, and it will be placed to the server, and then the server will respond. We'll see a little bit more details of this model. Okay, this is constrained application protocol, and this is used for machine-to-machine applications meant for constrained devices and networks. See, when we are talking of HTTP, HTTP does not have any concern with regard to the resource constraints within the devices which are using this. Though lately with mobile devices, there have been some changes to HTTP, but still HTTP requires a lot of power because the size of the data packets, or the total amount of data which HTTP will be transferring, that's quite large. So COAP, that is the constrained application protocol, that is designed mainly for IoT, and this is a request response model. So this is quite similar to what we have HTTP, but the overall resource requirements here is quite low actually, because it can work on lower bandwidths also. So graphics, etc., they are dealt in slightly different way in COAP. So supports methods, it does not have all the methods. Just see here, you have the GET, PUT, POST, HEAD, OPTIONS, TRACE, etc. Here, this is slightly lightweight, so you have only the limited number of methods within the application protocol, that is the COAP. Okay, now the application layer protocol WebSocket is a very widely used protocol actually, and this is a full duplex communication over single socket and based on TCP. And here the client can either be a browser, IoT device, or mobile application. So I'll discuss a little bit more details of WebSocket a little later, but this is a development kind of a development tool actually, which is used for connecting the applications with the rest of the applications. Then you have the message queue telemetry transport. This is a lightweight messaging protocol, and it's based on the first model, that is WebSocket, that is based on TCP, and the COAP is based on request response, whereas MQTT is based on publish and subscribe. These are two standard models which are used in pervasive computing and ubiquitous computing. I'll discuss some more details of these two models down the lecture. And MQTT is specially designed for constrained environments where devices have limited processing, low memory, and network bandwidth requirements. So unlike HTTP, which is basically the design was for a desktop application, desktop dealing with a server, huge server. So that requires a lot of bandwidth as well as the other resources, that is the processing is also quite demanding. In case of HTTP, the protocol requirements for IoT needs to be that the protocols are lightweight. Lightweight here means that the total power requirements and the capacity, the computing capacity requirements are low. XMPP is the extensible messaging and presence protocol. So this is for real-time communication and streaming XML data between network entities, and it is used for applications like multi-party chat and voice video calls. And it's a decentralized protocol. Then you have the data distribution service. It's a data-centric middleware standard, and it's for device-to-device or machine-to-machine communication. It again works on the publish-subscribe model, where publishers create topics to which subscribers can use. And a very small example, if I give for the publish subscribe, is your Play Store, Google Play Store or iOS Play Store, where you have the applications, and so that is publication. So that is published, and you have subscribed to that particular Play Store. So what you can do is you can get the apps from there and install them. So that's how the publish subscriber models are. Now, in a mobile application, that is this way. Whereas if it is information centric, then there is a slight difference actually. I'll discuss that difference a little later. And the DDS, that is, it provides you quality of service control and configurable reliability. This is another protocol. So all these protocols, why I'm telling you is that there is a large number of protocols which are available, and depending upon the application, you can choose one of those protocols for different purposes. So you have supports both point-to-point and publisher-subscriber models, routing and queuing. So it has some more features in comparison to the earlier protocols, and then broker here receives messages from publishers and route them over connections to consumers through messaging queues. I'll discuss that in some more details actually. Okay. Now, having discussed a very small introduction of the protocols, this is how the logical design of the entire IoT would look like. Device here refers to the physical devices like sensors, whereas you will have the communication and the services built over it, and then the applications. Now remember, the two side pillars, that is the security and management, that is an integral part of any IoT application or IoT deployment. Okay, so you have to manage the entire system, and you will need to provide the security, and this needs to be taken care by the application. So the application should be an integrated system, which will provide you the management of the services as well as the devices within the entire system, and also provide you security and will take care of the security. And now security is application dependent, that what kind of security you are and what different services, security services you are looking for. Okay, and each one of them, so IoT system, where you will require, say, these devices and the management here, if you see, you have the identification, sensing, actuation, communication, management. So there are multiple tasks. And see, the most fascinating aspect is that all these things, or all these services, including the hardware and the software and the power, they are all packed into small devices, and sometimes the devices are so tiny in size that we may not even feel their presence if they are around us or they are placed on a thing actually. So in devices, you have the sensing, actuation, monitoring and control functions. Communication is IoT protocols. Services are like device monitoring, device control services, data publishing and data discovery, device discovery, management functions to govern the system, security, authentication, authorization, message and content integrity and data security. And then finally, you have the applications. Okay. Now, as we have discussed earlier, that there are certain protocols which work on request response models, and there is another set of protocols which work works on publish subscribe model. Now here is a depiction or the explanation of the request response model. In request response model, the request is always initiated by the client. Okay, so what happens is, the server is connected to a resource pool. Remember, this server may not have all the resources, and the resources may be there on some other servers also, but they will all be transferred to the client within the single response. So what happens here is that the client is connected to a particular server. Okay, so it receives request from client, processes request, looks up, oblique fetches those resources, looks up for those resources which are residing on this particular server. Whereas fetches up fetches the resources means the resources which are to be fetched from other servers or from other resource pools. So it may be some other data center or wherever it is. And all these will be packed into a response, a single response, and will be sent to the client, and client is responsible for consumption. So when the server receives a request, it decides how to respond, fetches the data, retrieves resource representations, prepares the response, and then sends the response to the client. Okay, last word, I'll just be telling you a little, just try to understand here. What happens here is that the resources may be in different format than requested or than the ones which are understood by the client. So server is responsible for those transformations also on the resources. Remember, the client is a very small device, so it may not have those kind of capabilities and capacities to really serve all the requests transform the data. So this responsibility is taken by the server, and the server will present the data to the client in the format which the client understands. So server has full knowledge of the client. Okay. Now this is a stateless communication model. What does it mean is that once this request is served, server forgets about this request completely. It does not store any data with regard to this request or anything with regard to this particular communication which has happened between this client and the server. Now, what does it mean basically is that if this request, for any reason, the response is lost, then there has to be a separate request, a new request has to be made. Similarly, if for any reason the client needs the data again, or some dynamic fields are there, still the data would be transported in full, because there is no way that you can communicate the state of the data from client to the community. Now, this is the another model. This model has one more entity, and that is called a broker entity actually. Now, why do we need this broker? Try to understand it. It's an intermediary between the publisher and the consumer, because publisher, as you see, we have in the mobile network, mobile devices, a Google Play Store, that is one publisher. Now, you cannot have infinite number or any number of publishers, but you can always have any number of brokers. This is like an stock exchange kind of arrangement, you can think, where you have one stock exchange and a large number of people are trading on those stock exchanges, and they are trading through these brokers. So what happens is the consumers subscribe to the broker services, and they submit somehow, they subscribe to these services to the broker based upon their interests. So the broker knows what are their interests. Say the very simple example, if you see, when you create your Google account, it asks for your interests. Your interest, that whether you are interested in news or movies or games and so on and so forth, sports or something like that. Now, these are the brokers actually. You can consider them to be the broking services. Okay, and once you have subscribed, once there is some change on the publisher in with regard to those, the broker will fetch those changes and forward them, or will push them towards the consumer. That's how this works actually. So if you see the arrow directions here, the arrow directions are one way. Once the consumer has subscribed to the broker, broker knows what kind of data the consumer is looking for. And broker and publisher, they are communicating with each other quite frequently. So moment there is some change in the data, publisher also knows which kind of services this particular broker is interested into. Okay, so it will send messages to topics which are there running on the brokers. And then these topics, depending upon which consumer has subscribed to which particular service topic, and the broker will push those data to the consumer. Okay, so publish subscribe is a communication model that involves publishers, brokers and consumers. There are three entities, unlike the previous one, where you have the client directly communicate with the server. Okay, and consumer subscribe to the topics which are managed by the broker. So now one consumer, it's not necessary that one consumer will subscribe only to one broker. It may subscribe to more than one broker as well, because depending upon the topic of interest, it can require the services from multiple brokers. Okay, this is a push-pull communication model. Now, earlier, these models are the service models and these are the communication models. Now, communication models, when we are talking, then how the data will be fetched or will be made available to the last device, actually, that's what it refers to. So there are two models. The first one is the push-pull communication model. So here what happens is the push-pull is a communication model in which the data producers, that is the publisher, push the data to the queues. So this is a queue actually. This is a queue. Okay, so whenever there is a data, it will be pushed onto the queue. And what it happens actually is that once this data has been pushed onto this queue, this link may get disconnected. Because remember, this is a wireless communication, and in wireless communication, the important aspect is that bandwidth may not be available all the time. So whenever the publisher gets the bandwidth, it pushes the data into the queues, which are closer to the consumer. Remember, publisher may be too far away. So it will push the data onto the queues, and the consumer may now get these data. They get this data either whenever it is available or whenever it is interested. So remember, this bandwidth, these are two separate sections actually. These two are separate sections here. And both the bandwidths need to be available. Now, by putting these queues in between, what we are doing is that rather than requiring this connectivity, an end-to-end connectivity, we are decoupling or we are partitioning this connectivity into two separate sections. That is what the purpose of having these queues in between is. So queues also act as buffer actually, because flow control as well as buffering will be provided by them. And so which helps in the situation when there is a mismatch between the rate at which the producers push data. So that is the flow control purpose, and rate at which the consumer pull the data. Pulling means at what speed the consumer is reading the data from these queues. Okay, now if suppose it's a slow bandwidth, if this is slow bandwidth, then this is fast link actually. So the data will be pushed onto the queues faster in comparison to the rate at which the consumer is pulling the data. These queues are passive queues. It's not that they will be downloading. No, it's not there. It is basically that it will be reading from the queues actually. This is another model actually. This is exclusive pair communication model. This is a fully duplex model actually, and it is connection oriented model. Remember here in push pull actually, it is something like whenever the connectivity is available, the data can be fetched. In case of exclusive pair communication model, it's a connection oriented model, and so a connection would be required to be set up. So first a connection would be set up. So just see these two messages. These are for connection setup. Then these two are once the connection is set up, it will remain open till the communication the connection is closed. And these are your data response. These are your the duration where actual data communication is happening here. Okay, and so the client will be making an exclusive pair, an end-to-end path with the server. So it's more like a connection-oriented service. And client and server can send message to each other after connection setup. And once you want to release the connection, again, there will be connection close request. So these are three different phases in this model. Okay. Now the next part of this is that because not all the all the developments are possible through a single application. So generally what we have is actually we need to have the APIs which can be integrated with the existing applications. So again here there are two standards. The first one is the representational state transfer, that is called the REST-based communication APIs. So this follows a request response communication model. Here what happens is you will create an HTTP request. The client will create an HTTP request, and then finally the resources will be transferred to the HTTP server after the authorization and all these things may be there. So basically what it does is it provides you the web services using the request response communication model. Okay, so these API, this REST-based API, what you can have your own application, which is and it uses the REST API, and then you can integrate it with another web-based application, where your data, you can get the data from the server using this particular method. So here again, these are some of its characteristics. Actually, you have the this is a client server model. This is again a stateless, as you have the HTTP. Then it is cacheable. It is layered system because these are the different layers here. Then it's a uniform interface and code on demand. So this code is also available on demand here. Okay, this is a more elaborate communication API. So it allows bidirectional full duplex communication, that is web socket based. And it follows the exclusive pair communication model. So remember, now you can see all the things, how the different terminologies which we have used actually, how they are integrating or how they are really combined into the application development. So you have the push pull methods, you have the publish subscriber models, that is for the means how the data will be made available to the application. Then you have the communication models, which is either a request response model method or an exclusive pair communication model. And then you have the application programming interfaces, that is APIs, which can be used. So you have REST-based APIs, and then you have which uses a request response over HTTP. Whereas this is a communication API, WebSocket is another communication which is used for exclusive pair communication model. Okay, so again, it's an exclusive pair. So all the things will be there. So request for setup a WebSocket connection. So this is a connection will be set up. Then you will have the data frames, and then finally you will require to have the the closer. Okay, so this is the initial handshake over HTTP, and then you the WebSocket connection takes over, and then what you have is the closing connection. So that's how all these things are integrated into a single application. And this is a very small table actually, which tells you how this how these two approaches are different from each other. REST is stateless, whereas WebSocket is stateful. And the scalability is the important issue actually. I'll just explain it a little bit more. REST is basically both horizontal and vertical are easier here, whereas here it's only the vertical which is easier. Why horizontal is not easier? Try to understand it. See, horizontal means you have multiple servers, more number of servers. Okay, now remember, if you have more number of servers, then the number of connections to be set up in a web socket actually, that will be very large. And so the horizontal is slightly more difficult, whereas vertical, when we are talking, the vertical communication basically means that the different how much of data is to be brought actually. So the horizontal and vertical in case of the REST actually, both are easily possible, whereas in WebSocket only vertical is easier. Overhead of headers is not there. I think these are all standard in connection oriented and connection less protocols, whatever we have, all those differences are there except this scalability issue. And remember, every connection oriented service, it has its limitation when it comes to scalability for this reason only. Okay, so having discussed few technologies of the protocol stack within the IoT framework, now let me just focus on some more technologies which are used to make this technology or the IoTs really useful for deployment actually. That is a very, very important aspect, that how to make them possible for deployment. And there are, in fact, only four technologies I have listed here. There may be a couple of more technology apart from communication, because communication I have already discussed. So I have not discussed the communication technologies here. I have not listed. But yes, communication is also another technology which needs to be taken care of. Now, I'll give you a small and a brief insight into each of these technologies and how they are related to the IoT. Just try to understand it. What is the WSN and how they are? So WSN is distributed devices with sensors used to monitor the environmental and physical conditions, and consists of several end nodes acting as routers or coordinators too. See, just try to understand, I'll give you, see. What happens is, suppose this is an area where you want to deploy the IoTs. Now, there are two ways of doing it. Either we can have an infrastructure, or we can have an ad hoc network. Now, IoT needs to be deployed in both of them. So either it can be an infrastructure network, particularly say you have, suppose you have the home network, then it is always possible to have an infrastructure kind of network where you have an access point, and access point, all the devices are connected to that access point, and you are communicating through the access point. But there may be quite a few situations, particularly in applications like military applications, it may not be possible to lay the infrastructure, and so you have to have the ad hoc networks. The moment you have the ad hoc networks, you will need to incorporate, or the data transmission has to use the ad hoc network technologies, and which are very this, in that case, this becomes more like a WSN. Now, WSN again, see, this is a similar technology, may not be exactly same, but it is also a similar technology, with the only exception here is that the power in WSNs is even limited further. So the total energy available with the sensors or then within the network is very small. So what happens is all these nodes, because you do not have an infrastructure, so the ad hoc nature, that is the routing, the data aggregation, all these need to be prepared. You need to use the WSN technologies here, which are mainly regarding routing. Then you have data aggregation. In most of the WSN, these are essential component of WSN technologies. Now, if it is an infrastructure network, then data aggregation we may not talk much in case of the IoT. But the moment IoT uses the ad hoc networks and the WSN framework actually of for deployment, then yes, data aggregation becomes an important requirement. So it consists of several end nodes acting as routers or coordinators too. So that is the same actually as you have the IoT end devices. The even in IoT end devices, the sensors in WSN and in the IoT devices are more or less identical. So coordinators collects data from all nodes, act as gateway that connects WSN to the internet, and then routers route the data packets from end nodes to the coordinators. So all these things within WSN frameworks are different in case, I mean, because of their ad hoc nature. In comparison to the infrastructure networks. So WSN is an important technology which needs to be taken care while dealing with the IoT. So you may have, see IoT and whereas examples of WSN in IoT and where we use the protocols also. So weather monitoring systems, the indoor air quality monitoring systems, the soil moisture monitoring systems. Again, here it may not be possible to have an infrastructure. And then you have the surveillance systems. There you use some proprietary protocols so that you are not caught. So again, these have to be slightly different than your health monitoring system. In WSN, the data link layer protocol is more or less standardized, and that is Zigbee. So the operating system used here is Zigbee, and it is more or less now standardized. Okay. Now, this is where most of the work is now going on. And I think the other speakers, particularly Dr. Manish, actually, he might have discussed about the sensing as a service model of the clouds, actually, which are being offered. Now, why it's very, very important, try to understand, actually. The very, very important aspect is the moment sensing as a service model is provided by the cloud service providers, the reach of the IoT improves tremendously. Say, here if you see, this is a burger, this is a car, this is a bridge, this is a mobile device, this is an oven, and this is some health monitoring system, this is the road infrastructure, this is some kiosk, which is some food dispenser or a coffee machine, something like that. Now, all of them, see, this is mobile, this is consumable, this is a completely stationary item, and so on and so forth. And each one of them is generating data. Each one of them is generating a data. Now, if we assume that we want to collect this data separately from each one of them, yes, that becomes a very, very tedious job, because and that will be very, very expensive. So what we can do is this part, if you see, it has again two components. So these data producers, they are connected to the sensor publishers, whosoever has deployed this. And these publishers, which are collecting the data, they connect to the clouds actually. Now, what is the importance of this? Just try to understand it. See, if only this publisher, suppose this publisher is collecting the data only from this car, then it can get the information with regard to this car only. Okay. And this publisher, if I assume that this is monitoring the health of this particular bridge, or the third one is monitoring the traffic on this road, now if all the three start communicating or cooperating with each other, then what will happen here is that suppose this bridge develops some fault, then this can be communicated to the car that okay, please do not pass through this bridge because there is some structural defect coming into this particular bridge, or there is some safety concerns or some repairs are going on, or for some reason this is closed. Same is with the traffic, that in real time this publisher which is monitoring the traffic on this road can suggest this car to take another route, and in fact the route can also be suggested by it. So with this model, what is happening is all these three or n number of service providers, they can integrate into a single service provider model, which is providing a host of services, and these services can be used by anybody, a factory or an office or a doctor or a person or whosoever it is. And so what is happening here is that you never know that where the data is coming from. You are not interested in that. What you are interested in is that if you want to travel from Kota to Jaipur or from Jaipur to Kota, then which route you should take, and you need to keep the information in real time. So if there is something, some changes are to be made, you don't require to really plan it again sitting in your car. Your car is really, your service provider is updating you continuously. So cloud technology in that sense has become very, very important, but it imposes or it requires some additional constraints actually, or some additional capabilities, that all the data processing and data corroboration is done by the cloud. Okay, and so all of them need to provide the data, but at the same time the privacy and the security becomes a good concern, whether a big concern, I'll call it, whether it's a good or a bad concern, that's the users to decide, but yes, it becomes a quite big concern here. So it's basically that when you are having an isolated model without a cloud, then sensing becomes an isolated job, and not many applications can be built, or the applications, even if they are built, they may not serve the whole purpose. But the moment you have a cloud based or sensing as a service model offered through the cloud, then it delivers application and services over the internet, and then everything is provided into a single service actually. So computing, networking, storage, cloud perform services as all these services, infrastructure service, then rent infrastructure. So whatever you want, you can get through the cloud computing. Okay. The third technology which is of interest is the big data analytics, that where it comes to into play. See, in my opinion, this is the final outcome, or this is the final, the end technology which you require, except there is another technology which you will require is the visualization. Now what happens is sensor is producing the data, you are storing it on a cloud, but how will you process it? How will you process it? And that is where the big data analytics come into play. So collection of data whose volume, velocity and variety is too large, that is the standard characteristics of the big data, because if you see it from here, the different devices may provide you the different kind of data, which may be in different formats. So that's the variety. The volumes may be different. In fact, some may provide you the audio, another one may provide you the video, and so on and so forth. So the databases here, the standard, the traditional database techniques cannot be used here. You need to have some other technologies and techniques which is provided through the big data analytics. So the first and the foremost, the first task in big data analytics is data cleansing. That is removing the unwanted data, because out of this voluminous data, a very small portion of data is useful actually. So data cleansing, then you need to process that data, and then finally present it in a visualized form, so that it can be understood more easily. So lots of data is being collected and warehoused. So you have the web data, e-commerce purchases at department, grocery stores, and so on and so forth. So big data analytics is another technology. These are all characteristics of the big data analytics, and I hope these have been discussed by other speakers. So I'll not spend much time here. Okay, this is how the volumes are actually. The volumes are really large here. Okay. Now, basically, now I'll tell means come to the final part of this talk actually, and that is with regard to the different deployment templates which are available under IoT. See, depending upon your application, it's not that you have some standard techniques here or standard deployment templates that okay, one size will fit to all. No, that is not the case. Depending upon your application and your budget, you have the different deployment templates. There are six which have been identified. So you have the devices, which are the sensing devices, then you have the resources. So the software components of the IoT device for accessing, processing and storing, and then you have the controller services. So it's the native service that runs on the device and interacts with the web services. I'll just tell you, you have the databases, you have the web services, the analysis component, and finally you have the application. So these are the multiple components within the entire IoT framework actually. Okay, now this is the simplest and the most basic deployment model. We call it an IoT level one. See, what happens here is there is no cloud. That is the first aspect. There is no cloud involved, and there is only one controller and one device. So level one IoT has a single node oblique device. There is only one device. Then see the definition of the resources here. The resources are software components on the IoT device for accessing, processing, and storing. And it has limited resources. So the processor, etc., again are quite resource very small here. Okay, and then you have the controller services, which are running. So all these three may run into a single device actually. Okay, and this is your monitoring node or the environment where the data, which is generating this data or which is causing this data, and finally device is sensing that data. Okay, then this will put the data into a single database. This database may be any type of database. So maybe a tabular database or whatever database it may be. And then your application will get this data through either a REST or a WebSocket services. So this is the final application here. This is a very the most basic model of deployment. And generally in laboratories, when we ask the students to perform certain experiments, then generally this model we start with. So you can give them a temperature sensor, ask them to find out what is the maximum temperature of the day. That will be your application. Okay, so the database will be storing the temperatures of the day, and then your application will keep updating that, okay, what is the maximum temperature of the day, or say you want an hourly temperature, then you can get the hourly temperatures. Okay. So this is one example. This is a home automation system we are talking. So here you have a sensor for a mailbox, the doorbell, the intrusion, the electric pot, the air conditioner control, your sprinkler, and all of them are communicating to to an access point, and all of them, this is connected to the control panel. This may be a final desktop kind of system, and then this is your control panel. So you are connecting them this way. Remember, they are not communicating with each other. So if suppose you have a tank, actually, if you have a tank, then this sprinkler may not come to know that there is a water, the water level in the tanker is low, tank is low. So it can send an alarm. No, nothing like that. There is no communication from one sensor to the another sensor. Okay, now this is the second model actually. This is the level two method. What is happening here is the only change here is that the database resides on the cloud actually. That is what the difference is. Otherwise, most other things are the same. And so your application, which were earlier getting the data from the local machine here, which is installed on the premises, now this will be, this database is now resting on the cloud. So single node that performs sensing or the actuation, data is stored in the cloud, and the application is usually a cloud based application. That's the only difference. So these are solutions, these are suitable for solutions where the data involved is big. However, the primary analysis requirements is not computationally intensive and can be done locally. So once you have got this data from here, your application is processing the data. So smart irrigation, this is an example here. So depending upon the temperature, moisture and pressure, what you are doing all of them, and then you are putting all this data onto the cloud, and irrigation system is controlled this way. Remember, now the data is on the cloud, so you can get access to the full data. This is the level three communication, the level three deployment. Now, single node, data is stored and analyzed in the cloud. That is where the definition. Remember, here the data is still, the analysis is carried out locally, but in level three, the analysis part is also carried out on the cloud. That's the only difference you have. Otherwise, still it's a single device. It is still a single device. Okay, so tracking package handling is used our accelerometer and gyroscope. So depending upon means this, you can keep a track of the package handling, how many packets have been placed into the truck and where the truck is going. Okay, now this is a level four deployment. In level four deployment, now the number of nodes, which were earlier only one, now you have multiple nodes. So system has multiple nodes, which, and first it will perform a local analysis. Data is stored in the cloud, and the application is a cloud-based application. So the app, the analysis is carried out locally. Okay, and level four contains local and cloud-based observer nodes, which can subscribe to and receive information collected in the cloud from IoT devices. So you have these observer nodes. So this is a new addition here. Now here, if you see this, the analytical component which resides on the cloud, actually it gets the data from the cloud, and it is where the intelligence it adds to. So application can get the intelligence of the cloud also. And the observer nodes, these are like your broker nodes or the brokers, which can get the data from the field. So they are suitable for solutions where multiple nodes are required, the data involved is big, and the analysis requirements are computationally intensive. So just see the noise monitoring. So from different sources, you have the noise coming from different sources, from different areas. So you will be putting that into the cloud actually, and then finally making this data available to multiple parties and analyzing it also for to different applications. So you can use it for other purposes also. Okay. This is the level five. Actually, now you have one more entity, and that is called the coordinator node. So what you have here is the data, the endpoint devices, these devices which are there. Now they can communicate through coordinator to the cloud. Earlier, each one of them was communicating separately. Each one of them is communicating separately to the cloud. Whereas in level five, actually, or the deployment level five, you have a cloud, a coordinator, and data aggregation may be carried out by this coordinator. And so the overall data presented to the cloud for storage and analysis, that changes a little bit. And this is something like a pre-processing of data which happens here. So the end nodes perform the sensing and actuation. The coordinator node collects data from the end nodes and sends it to the cloud. That is a big difference actually. And data is stored and analyzed in the cloud, and the application is again a cloud-based application. And these are for wireless sensor networks based applications, where these endpoint devices are your sensor networks actually. These are all sensor networks which are sending the data. Sorry, this is the coordinator device. So these endpoints may be in the form of the sensor, a complete field actually, where the data is coming from, and then this coordinator is sending the data. So in which the data involved is big, and the analysis requirements are also computationally quite intensive. Okay, and this is the IoT level 6 actually. Here everything is combined into a single deployment level now. So whatever is the complexity, you can assume. So you have a centralized controller through which all the devices will be communicating to the cloud. And then you have the analytics also here. Then you have the observers, which were not there in level 5. If you see, these are there in the observer 5 also. So, but you have a centralized controller, which is playing the role of a centralized coordinator or a centralized controller for all these different sensors. So this is, it has multiple independent data nodes that perform sensing and actuation. And the data is again stored in the cloud. Analytics component analyzes the data and stores the results in the cloud database. And the results are visualized with the cloud-based application. And the centralized controller is aware of the status of all the end nodes. That is where the monitoring happens actually. And sends control commands to the nodes. That's what the difference in the 5 and 6 is. Okay, the challenges are enormous, and connectivity I have already discussed. So keeping them connected, power management, that is the biggest challenge actually. Security is another challenge. In fact, we can keep discussing about the security for any duration. But just for the timing, I'll not be touching upon the security. But the security concerns are really large in case of IoT, and the privacy concerns are also getting added to the IoT. Rapid evolution, that is basically that the technologies are changing very, very fast, whether it is the software technologies or the hardware technologies. So you need to cope up with the time actually. Okay, so I thank you all for this giving me a patient hearing. So that's what I had planned for the 2 days of this talk. So I'll take few questions from you, and I have some time, so I'll give you a brief introduction of one more technology. Let me just see where it is. Yeah. So, but before I go to that topic actually, and that is on localization actually, I'll take a few minutes. I'll take from you, as well as I'll give it to you. If you have any questions on what we have discussed so far, please pose those questions to me, raise those questions so that we can discuss. Otherwise, I'll give you a very, may not be more than 15 minutes actually, I'll take just to introduce you to the concept of localization and what are the different techniques which are there in the localization. So there are no questions. Okay. Now, this is what the localization, the purpose of localization is. I'll take a minute. See, particularly in Industry 4.0, this has become very, very important to find it out that where the data is coming from, exact location. In fact, for a very simple reason, that even identities can be false to you. We have the security concerns, And there are security risks within the IoT paradigm. The entire framework is not, you can say, foolproof against any kind of saboteurs and any kind of attacks. So localization is one of the technologies which are used to discover the exact geographic location or position of a device where the data is coming from. So localization of a node refers to the problem of identifying its spatial coordinates in some coordinate system. It may be either a 2D coordinate system or a 3D space. So this is a very, very important technology in that sense, actually. Okay. Now, a few people may say that it's very simple. We can simply have a GPS on every IoT device. Yes, it appears to be simple, but having GPS on every device, IoT device, that makes the IoTs very expensive. That is number one. And not only in terms of the money, the cost of, in terms of money, but the cost in terms of energy and the size is also very large. So putting the GPS every time may not be feasible. And so we require these localization techniques to find out that where the data is coming from. And there are other applications also. Location of sensed events in the physical world, this I have already discussed. Then you have some location aware services. So particularly in mobile computing, and we discuss about it, that the location aware services you need to provide. So location often primary sensors of information, so supply chain management and surveillance, object tracking. So all these things require you to really work on the localization aspect. Okay, so the technologies, there are two classes of technologies, and one is called the global positioning and another is the relative position. So not every application requires a global positioning. So GPS in that sense is also not very, very good idea because it's quite expensive. So global position, when we are talking, it position within the general global reference framework. So what we are looking for is, through GPS, we want to find out the longitudes and the latitudes. And then you have the universal traverse marketer or UTM, zones and latitude bands. So that is what the global positioning is. But generally, quite a few applications require only the relative position, and based on the arbitrary coordinate system and reference frames, actually. Say, particularly in wireless sensor networks, what happens is, suppose this is a field, actually. We already know the coordinates of this field. Though I have shown it here to be a rectangular field, may not be rectangular, but we all know the coordinates of the field, and then the sensors may be deployed quite arbitrarily in a random fashion, actually. So what we are looking for is, we do not want an absolute position here. What we want is that we want a relative position with respect to the within this field, actually, what is its position. So we want this coordinate. Once we know this coordinate with respect to this, we can always get the absolute coordinates of this particular sensor, and that's how it works, actually. So based on arbitrary coordinate systems and reference frames and distances between sensors without any relationship to the global coordinates, that is also sometimes we require, particularly in routing within the wireless sensor networks, we require it. Okay, and there are the conflicting ones, actually. The accuracy versus precision. GPS is true within 10 meter for 90% of all measurements. So accuracy is 10 meter. So how close is the reading to the ground? That is accuracy. And precision is 90%. How consistent are the readings, actually? And so the technology needs to be weighed on these two aspects. And the information, whether it is a symbolic information, so symbolic position information, say office 354 or mile marker 17. So these are the different ways of getting the positions. Okay, I'll just come to just forget about this theory part, actually. Okay. No, I think. Yeah. So this is how these are classified actually. There are range based and the range free. Okay, so in range based actually you have the four different techniques. RSSI, time of arrival. Then you have the time difference of arrival and angle of arrival, and where you have the hop counting techniques and the local techniques in range free. I'll just give you a very brief of this basically. Okay, this is complete mathematics actually. So yeah, see what happens in time of arrival basically. Say if you know that at what time you have started, and you can record the time of your arrival. You know the distance, so distance is known, speed is also known. So t is equal to d upon s. That's how. So distance between sender and receiver of a signal can be determined using the measured signal propagation time and known signal velocity. That's how it works. So sound waves 343 meter per second, approximately 30 milliseconds to travel 10 meters, and radio signals 300 kilometers per second, so 30 nanoseconds to travel to 10 meters. So there are means how do we do is actually in one way time of arrival, this is how the distance is computed. And in two way, actually we do it this way. That is, we take the time of one means in both the directions, and then divide it by two. This is time difference of arrival. Here the problem is the clock synchronization is a big problem in time of arrival. Whereas in time difference of arrival, when we see this clock synchronization problem is avoided. So basically, what we do is we have a T1 to T2. So two signals with different velocities are sent, and then we find the difference in the time arrival. So V1 minus V2 is start T4 minus T2 minus T weight. This is your T weight actually. This is your T weight. Okay, and so no clock synchronization is required. That is the big advantage here. Okay, then you have the angle of arrival. So direction of signal propagation that determines the speed. So this is a very common technique actually. Received signal strength speed. So basically, this uses this philosophy actually, that the attenuation is inversely proportional to the square of the distance. So basically based upon this principle, the received signal strength is measured. It's an indicator, and so depending upon what RSSI is, we can find out this R, whether R to the power n we can find out, and then n is already fixed actually, and so we can find out the distance. That's how the RSSI techniques work. These are more accurate techniques which are highly means mathematical oriented. So you have the triangulation. Here you can find only the distances, but in triangulation you can find, through triangulation and multilation, you can find out the exact coordinates of the systems, devices. So this is how you can just see. This is trilateration and angulation combined. So lateration is distances between entities are used. In angulation, angle between nodes are used. So if you see here, these three different signals are required, and you can find out the exact location using these techniques. So I'm just introducing you to the terms actually, so that you can work more and you can read a little bit more about this. GPS based localization is another one. You have the distance estimation, then you have the scene analysis. So radar systems, because they work on the scene analysis, but they require the localization also. The bounding box is another technique actually. Each one of them can be discussed for hours together actually. So my purpose of really discussing making a presentation of this is just to introduce you to the term localization and how it is used in the context of the IoT, and the most important applications of localization are in Industry 4.0. So I'll conclude my talk at this point. If you have any questions, you can ask me. I have stopped by sharing my screen actually, and I can now I have switched on my camera also. Okay, so Dr. Vipal, are you there? So thank you very much for listening to me that patiently. Thank you.